Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Talking on how e-science can help to investigate tipping points in tropical ecosystems. So please welcome Marina. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It's a real pleasure to be here. So first of all, I'd like to thank Juliano Salis for inviting me to be here, especially because I'm not a computer scientist. So I have a very mixed background. So I'm here to expose more the ideas and to have a feedback on what could be done or not. We started some months ago with some fellows from computer sciences. So here are some of the ideas of our proposal and project together, not really results or things like this. So first of all, because it's a very heterogeneous audience, I'd like to present the object of my studies, and it's related to savannas and forests along the tropical belts of the world. Particularly here, I'm showing in this left-hand side here, the Cerrados in Brazil, from the ground and from a tower, measurement tower of 15 meter high. And here, I'm in the middle of the Amazon and up sky in the Amazon in a tower of measurements of 40 meters. So it's very different, but the thing is that one can become another or the other can become one. And in which conditions this might help or not? Is this feasible or not? That's most of our motivation to study these ecosystems nowadays, because everything is changing and we can have a flip towards one or another biome. So what I'm guiding you today through is how a science can help investigating these tipping points. Originally in my presentation, I had included here ecosystems, but after 1.5 days of presentations, I changed it for biomes because people yesterday showed results on other ecosystems. So I'm changing a little bit just to make it more clear. So first of all, I'll show you the motivation for this work and why this is important nowadays. How we approach the problem in terms of dynamical system theory or mathematical equations, how we approach it. After that, some drawbacks and issues that came up, criticisms from the literature and people that said, well, this is not really this, so you should take care and be careful in saying things like this. And how e-science can overcome these drawbacks and help us understanding better the systems. So one of the motivations to start this work was some extreme climatic events that went on in the Amazon basin. So this is 2005, and this one is 2010. And they helped mainly because of the warming in North Atlantic Ocean. So this creates anomalies in the circulation of the atmosphere, and makes the Amazon a bit drought because it decreases precipitation over the basin. So in here we have two episodes, and for the ones who have been to the Amazon basin, you probably know that population, local population needs a lot of these rivers, and if it dries out, then we have a problem because they need it for transportation, for eating, for fishing, for having baths and things like that. So it's extremely bad for a population if you have droughts like this, and unexpected droughts mainly. So most of the previous droughts were caused by El Nino events, and they are very different in intensity and the distribution along the basin. So in terms of scientific literature, what we have here is an index of drought, and it's related to tree mortality along the basin. So in 2005, we see here the redder the worst. So we see here that the southwestern parts of the basin were very affected. And in 2010, 5 years after, we have a much more intense drought along southern Amazon, which can cause loss of resilience in the system. So the system can be affected by these frequent and intense droughts, and this could cause some flips towards different ecosystems or different structure and functionality. So the first question would be, how resilient are tropical South American biomes? Are they resilient enough to support these sort of extreme events and deforestation rates and other disturbances? And this was evaluated, lots of different perturbations and systems around the world were evaluated by a group of scientists from different areas. And the Amazon rainforest was classified as top five tipping elements of the Earth system. So in here we have the feature of the system, which happens to be tree cover or tree fraction. And from the IPCC reports, we have a rough idea that precipitation will decrease. This is not a common sense, but it seems that precipitation will decrease along the basin. And by decreasing precipitation and increasing temperature, you could have a gradual, but not so gradual, change in the ecosystem functionality. So biodiversity loss and decrease rainfall, this would change dramatically how the system behaves. It's not going to be in the current state anymore. And also models show us that looking forward in South America, you see here forests in green and savannas or cerrados in pink. So this is the current configuration. If you apply precipitation and temperature scenarios, very optimistic ones, you could lose parts of the eastern and northern Amazon here towards a savanna. So you would replace it by a savanna cover. And in a more pessimistic scenario of decreasing precipitation and increasing temperature, you would have a lot more losses than only in this one. In any case, however, you do have losses here, and you could have a new configuration of the system, and this can cause damage in the population ecosystem services and in their life, of course. So in here, we would have two different states of the system, one the way we see now, and another one covered mostly by savannas. Here we have another simulation experiment looking backwards in Africa to a different period called Holocene, which is about 6,000 years ago. So in here we have the Sahara Desert the way it is today, and the Sahara Desert the way it used to be. And in the middle of Holocene, we had a temperature about 3 or 4 degrees upper. Or higher, sorry. So in here we would have a greener equilibrium, and the Sahara could have been vegetated indeed by trees and grasses instead of only sand. And this is supported by palynological evidences, or which means pollen from the trees and from the vegetation here. They collected this in the ocean aside, and they saw that the species in here were much more related to to a configuration much more related to vegetated state than to a desert-like state. So in this, we ask, are there indeed these catastrophic shifts? Can ecosystems change from one to the other state in a very rapid way? And by rapid, I mean 50 years, because the climate inertia is very long. So for us, 50 years is most of our lives, but for the climate is nothing. So how we try to represent that? Using dynamic system theory. So in here, I show the theoretical idea on how we did this in a very simple way. We started this this up. So linear shifts are like this. So I have ecosystem state and the conditions. So we can think of precipitation, soil moisture, and so on, and how the state, how the ecosystem behaves. In here, we have a non-linear but still gradual change, like a sigmoid. And in here, we would have an abrupt shift, which means that for the same conditions of precipitation, for example, we have two stable states, one here and one here. So in here, we have, in this interval, we would have for the same conditions, this state and this state. And among these two stable states, we would have an unstable pathway here, separated by two tipping points. And this is the golden word nowadays for the Amazon, the tipping points in the Amazon. But I think we have to be a bit critical about it. So why use it, first of all? First, because this approach has been successfully applied to other ecosystems, especially in aquatic ecosystems, in lakes and in coral reefs. And it was very successful in representing the changes that these ecosystems went through in the last few decades. Our systems, the systems we are trying to model and represent here, they are composed mainly by feedback mechanisms. So one thing happens, and it's a domino effect. It goes and goes and goes, and it can change from one state to the other because of these feedback mechanisms and synergistic effects among different variables of the system. So in this sense, it's feasible and it's reasonable to use this sort of theory to represent. So in here, just to make a remark that we say stable states, but the system is not really stable. It changes a long time. And what we do a mean state in here. But what happens is that the frequency that we have states in here have to be higher and low in order to classify different states. For example, in here we have a lot of the system staying in this state. And then we also have here down. So this is translated into graphs like this. So in this green part here, we have low chances of having this system in this state, in the lower state, and higher chances to have it in here, in the upper state. The opposite happens here. We have more chances to have it here, and less chances to have it up here. So I'm presenting this just because we are going to see some of the results, and they show these histograms, very simple histograms of frequency distribution. And also we can build potential landscapes like this, measuring the resilience of the system depending on the shallowness of the basin of attraction. So in here we would have more resilient, a more resilient system, and here a very shallow and less resilient. So if I just click on this ball, this could flip towards this state here. That's why resilience is low. And the opposite is here. You see here that is very deep, so it's much more difficult to move and to flip this ball in here to this state. So these are mostly the ways we have to identify stable states in systems in general. And then once you did this, you can come up with this potential landscapes for each one of the conditions you have here. So in here, we have only potential landscape for one slice of this figure. And then if you pick up all the slices, you have different configurations. So for example, for this conditions, you have bistability. If the ecosystem state were a tree cover, for example, then you would have savannas and trees possible in this, the possibility to have savannas and trees in here and in here and in here, and then here only forest and here only savanna, for example. But then the question is, can we rely only on theory and models? And this is mostly what's been going on. In my personal opinion, people are saying that there are tipping points in the Amazon, but we barely understand the system and all the processes that happens there. So I think we have to go deep and understand the system better before saying that there are tipping points, that after we cross this tipping point, there is no going back. I'm a bit skeptical about that. So what we did, we used remote sensing data to analyze alternative stable states using data, not only models, not only theory. And then very simply, what we did for the tropics, we got this MODIS product called tree cover percentage. And from South America, from Africa, and we cut off the Sahara Desert because to avoid bias towards a treeless state or a desert state. And we cut off also the Australian outback. And we got Australia as well, and we crossed with precipitation, mean annual precipitation data in here. And the first graph we did was this one, the frequency of tree cover, to see if there are peaks and if the distribution is multimodal, like the one we saw in the beginning in the theoretical framework. And what we see, it is. And in the first look, at first glimpse, I didn't see anything here, but my boss did. He saw a treeless state here, so there are more chances, or this is what the frequency in a histogram shows, there are more chances that you are in this classification, which means 0 to 5% in tree cover, than to be here, 10%. And in here, 20% more chances than in here, 60%. And the same for this peak, 80%. So we classify this as a state called treeless, which means no trees, which can be bare land or a grassland. A savanna state between 5 and 60%, and a forest state more than 60%. Very empirical classification. And then to check for this sort of theoretical graph, we put mean annual precipitation as conditions for the state and tree cover percentage as the ecosystem state. And we came up with this figure. And again, I didn't see anything in the beginning, but my bosses did. And they did see this. So in here you have, this is the histogram, but separated by precipitation ranges, if you look closely. Because in here, the darker, the more frequent this percentage is. So in here, we can see that for the same conditions, we have two different states, treeless or savanna, and savanna or forest. And of course, nobody believes you if you just come up with empirical evidence. So we did a statistical procedure, which is very likely clusterization process, and we came up with three clusters, forest in this valley, and savanna in the valley, treeless in the valley, so you can see a bit darker here and greenish. And in here we have in white circles unstable states, so they are in the top, valleys and the peaks. And this was very nice to see, because then we could come up with this potential landscape showing that with real data, we can see differences in precipitation. So if you slice this out, you have tree estate very, very resilient. And in here, the tree estate and the savanna estate are possible for this precipitation. And for this precipitation, you have a different configuration. So here, forest becomes more resilient than savanna, and so on. There are other variables playing a role, of course, not only precipitation. And this work evaluates dry season length. So the difference between what we can see in very simple terms is that the Amazon and the Cerrado have a very simple difference in terms of water and the water they receive. In the Cerrado, you have a very drought, a pronounced drought in July, for example. And in the Amazon, it's much more continuous. And that's why we have, or these authors evaluated the dry season length, the duration of the dry season. And what we can see here is that for less than 7 months, forests exist. So forests are these yellowish crosses. And I'm not going to talk about Australia much because it's not very representative. But in here we see South America and Africa. And also, the author separated the interval between 1,000 and 2,500 millimeters a year of precipitation to define where savannas and forests are coexisting here. So for an intermediate rainfall of 1,000 and 2,500 millimeters a year, you would have forests and savannas occurring at the same place, same conditions, two different states. So less than 7 months and this intermediate rainfall. And when they include fires for only the pixels with these characteristics here, what we see is that in the striped columns here, we see without fire, pixels without fire. So the distribution is mainly concentrated in the forest state for both South America and Africa. And when you include fire, this distribution changes and it becomes more a savanna state and less a forest state. The same happens in South America. So fire seems to be very strong predictors of this biostability. And we can say that because for the ones who are in Brazil and watched you the news, they know that deforestation and human activities are invading the basin with fires. So the picture we have now, what we know about tipping points in the system is like this. So you have a continuum between trees and grasses. You have grasslands, cerrados, and tropical forests. So in here, you have woody cover limited by water supply. It's very much deterministic. In here, you have canopy formation and forest canopy formation. And because of humidity within the canopy, you don't have fire spreading out and intensity is very low. And then you come up with this biostability around here between 1,000 and 2,500 millimeters per year due to fires, and this is very stochastic. So we have two ways of classifying our system. This is another biostability, and it's related to other properties. But for us here in South America, fire is the most important factor. So this is just to show that this have already happened in South America. This is an experimental setup, a local example of tipping points and what happens if you have a disturbance in the system. This is for good. So in here, what happens is that in northern Peru, El Niño events affect the system in a very different way. It rains more than normal. So normally you have 300 millimeters. And when you have an El Niño event, you would have 2,500 millimeters occurring per year. So people seed the ground very much in order to have trees growing. And they do succeed. So when they have the prediction of El Niño event, they do this and plants grow fast up because they are adapted. So they escape herbivory up and they escape drought that will come after by reaching with this their roots the water table below. So this happened, and from one tree you would have a more forested place. I'm going to skip this one because this is about fire and how they see the invasion of cerrado and pasture species after a fire event. And some of the drawbacks, data related drawback. So of course, remote sensing data are models, are products, so they carry uncertainties. And one way of overcoming this is reconciling most of the databases you have. So the other issue is the scale issue, and I'm going to skip it because I'm running out of time. And the other issue is the composition. So one way that e-science can help, they can aggregate and helping aggregate massive amounts of data, as has been said already. So these are the teams with the grant we got from Microsoft in São Paulo. They are working on this. So this is a master student and two researchers. And the other thing that e-science could help, and this came out from a coffee break, this is not in the original project, how spatial temporal differences matter and how emerging configuration characteristic is a savanna or not. And this can be done through multi-scale analysis and feature extraction using computer science techniques. Thank you very much. Sorry for the time. And these are the people, and I'd like to acknowledge them. They guide me through all this way, and some of them are still with me together, working together. So thank you very much, and sorry for the time.
Thank you, Marina.
So we have a couple minutes for questions. Is there any questions for Marina? No. A brief question regarding the data, the sensors. What kind of can you tell us a little bit more about the sensors? Just to
what do you mean? Which sensors?
You mentioned at some point that you were moving from models and theory to more collecting data directly. So is real sensors there being used and sources of that information?
No, the thing is that we are using remote sensing data. So the sensors are in the satellites. And these results are mainly MODIS related. Okay. So what happens is that they have spectral bands in the sensors. And by combining this, they come up with different products of MODIS. So we use one of the products, and it's called tree cover percentage. But apparently, they are, because of the algorithm that generates it, there are problems in this, the discontinuity or continuity of the data. And this may cause what we see in the histograms. So this is the criticism that we are trying to deal with now. This is the thing.
Thank you. Congratulations on your project. Thank you, Marina. Well, let's move to the next talk, which is going to be presented by Agma Traina from University of São Paulo, São Carlos. And she's going to be talking on big data.
Okay, good morning. This is a pleasure for me being here with you at the Faculty Summit to talk about the results and the developments that we achieved in our AgroDataMine project, what was funded by Microsoft Research and FAPESP from Brazil. Well, the main motivation of our project comes from the main challenge that has been posed to us, that is how to deal with the climate changes that leads to global warming that affects our life in the whole planet, In our project, we are more interested in the effects on the agriculture, because Brazil depends so much on the agriculture revenue. Well, we have a lot of sensors, a plethora of sensors that provide us with data that brings us information that can be very, very useful and important to extract knowledge that helps us to understand the climate and meteorological issues. In our project, we aimed at the creation of methods to filter, to analyze, to extract association patterns in order to analyze the climate data and the data gathered from remote sensing devices. I'm sorry, I pressed the wrong button. Well, we developed algorithms to analyze the outputs from local climate models that were reshaped to the Brazilian environment and to compare them with real measurements collected from the sensors that we get from remote sensing images as well as from surface stations, and to evaluate the quality of the data generated by the models and how they compare with the real data in order to provide mechanisms to fine-tune the climate data forecasts. Well, so we had to come up with mechanisms to provide data integration, because we received the data from several sources, to pre-process the data and to clean them in order to get the useful information that we aimed for. So the main sources of data that we've been working with are from satellites, mostly from the NOAA sensor, which by now we have more than 5 terabytes of data from images provided to us from CEPAGRI Unicamp and CEPETEC INPE, as well as time series, mostly provided by the AgriTempo system that has been developed by Embrapa, the Brazilian agricultural company funded by the federal government of Brazil, that provides us with more than 3 terabytes of data, as well as simulations of climate models that has been given to us from CEPETEC INPE, and we have more than 15 terabytes of data. So we have a big challenge, which is how to deal with this very large and heterogeneous data sources in acceptable time in order to provide knowledge for decision making of our specialists. So we are dealing with big data in this project. Well, the first step was how to summarize, to organize all the information that we've been received from remote sensing devices in order to process it in a faster way. So the first step was to provide image georeferencing in order to get at least 4 types of image data. So we did radiometric calibration, geometric correlation, and so on. Then we started to populate our climate and images databases. Then we can go to phase 2, where we extract the time series that summarize the sequences of images gathered. So we do that on multi-temporal images, building the time series through regions of the images or point by point, and computing the measurements that the specialists are interested in. Then we go to the mining phase on the time series, where we do quantization process, association pattern generations, and the rules presentation. The first tool that we developed in order to help in our goals was the SAT Image Explorer. That it is a tool that allows us to get the sequences of images and to ask to the specialist to to draw or to place the region where he or she is interested in analyzing. And from this region, we built the time series that are computed over a formula, an equation that the specialist is interested in. So we built automatically the whole time series is extrapolating the region that was marked from one image from the series. In this example, I'm showing the normalized difference vegetation index, which is a measurement that provides us with how robust is the plant or, to be cropped. So it provides us with the vegetative vigor of the area. This system was very interesting because the specialists could tune their formulae and place with the results in a very fast way. Well, at this point, I'd like to stop a little bit and provide a little background on one of the main techniques that we have employed so far, which are based on the fractal theory. Well, what is a fractal? Fractal, we can say that are objects that present the self-similarity property, which means that the object resembles to itself at several ranges of scales. Let's exemplify it. If I have a lot of points along a line in a resolution of 1:1, I see the points like a line. If I magnify it to a finer resolution, I still see points along a line. I still see a line. If I do it again to an even finer resolution, I still come up with points along a line. So it doesn't matter if I have points along a line in a two-dimensional space where I have the embedded dimension equal to 2, but the intrinsic dimension equal to 1. If I go to a three-dimensional space where I still have points along a line, I'm going to have the embedded dimension equals to 3 and the intrinsic dimension equals to 1. So it doesn't matter the embedding dimension. What I am looking for is the intrinsic dimension, what actually tells me the real measurement of the data that I am evaluating. Well, there are several ways of computing the fractal dimension of data sets. We've been employed so far the correlation approach, which is a method based on the box counting on this kind of formula here. And we developed a very fast method which has linear cost on the number of elements of the data set. So it is well suited to work with data streams because it is scalable too. And we presented it in 2000 and we improved it in 2011. Well, so that is enough for the intuition that I needed to provide to you, because we employed the fractal concepts in order to analyze our time series. So we applied the algorithm to compute the time series dimensions over several window time frames. So together with statistical methods and clustering algorithms, we are able to analyze how the data streams behavior and to see which attributes are meaningful to our climate models or not. Here, I'm sorry, it's not so easy to see. It's a little bit dark, I think, but we can see that if we are looking at real data provided by AgriTempo for a time series of precipitation and temperature for a period of 30 years, so we have the real data from 25 ground-based meteorological stations of São Paulo State, we can see that we should see that the fractal dimension here doesn't go over a range, a small range, but there are some peaks here that corresponds, that matches to the phenomenon El Niño. When we do the same for the estimated data provided to us for the same region from the global climate research for the same data, we should see here that you have a much broader variation. We don't have this kind of behavior. We cannot spot the regions where would be the El Niño. Well, this tells us, this was the beginning for us, to note that something was not so good with the models. So using this approach and other statistical measurements, we built a tool that can be composed by several elements here, which are built like a pipeline, and come up with the results by time series elements. So looking again, we can see in green here the behavior of the data regarding the real data, and in blue for the model data. So we can see, we can easily spot the discrepancies, as well as we can note the behavior of every attribute of the series. Another way that we wanted to work is how to spot extreme events in time series. So we needed to discretize the time series. We employed three types of patterns: the pattern V, the combination of descending event and the ascending event, the pattern mountain M, and the pattern plateau. And we can then discretize the time series, compute the histograms of them, and see when the time series achieves some values that can be classified as extreme events. And this can be processed and visualized in a very fast way by the specialists, demanding less effort than the approach that they usually do. Well, for example, let's see a very long time series composed of more than 100 years measurements of precipitation for the Campinas region of the state of São Paulo, Brazil. We divided the time series into 10 pieces, and we looked at the extremes in the time series, and it was interesting to observe that in the beginning of the series, the extreme valleys were not as intense as the extreme valleys at the end of the time series, like the climatologists are telling us so far. So for validation processes, we've been comparing the results of real data and the outputs of the climate data model, employing the ETA model that the CPTEC has reshaped for the Brazilian perspectives. And we evaluated the results on two types of crops. Sugarcane, it's a very important commodity for the Brazil, which is positively affected by the increasing of the temperature, and coffee crops, which is the opposite. It is negatively affected by the increasing in the temperature. So we started looking at the behavior of the sugarcane cycle during the year. So for doing that, we first asked to the specialists to build masks of the region of the state of São Paulo where we should have sugarcane plantations. So we got the NOAA images, which are very low resolution images, 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer is the size of the pixel. And we computed using the Sat Image Explorer the time series considering the NDVI values that provide us with the vegetative vigor of the region. We applied clustering methods, and we could spot in a blink of the eyes the results where we have the sugarcane growing and being cropped. So in blue, we have the regions where we have low in DVI, which means that the sugarcane is not ready to be cropped. In red, we have the high NDVI valleys where the sugarcanes are ready to be cropped. So we can see that in the winter time in Brazil, which is July, actually end of June, July, August, we have the harvest of the sugarcane. So we have a movement from blue, from red to blue. And in the spring and summer, we have the opposite. We have the sugarcane growing up, so we have a movement between blue to red, like we can see here, or we can see in an animated way, like this. Well, this is a management tool for the people who plant sugarcane there. Well, regarding coffee crops, we wanted to be able to spot automatically the regions where we have coffee. So we employed high resolution images and the automatic labeling of the images. So from GeoEye satellite images, we applied some feature extraction based mostly on Gabor filters and applied cluster identification using the multi-resolution correlation clustering method that we developed and was presented on ICDM 2010. And we applied low labor labeling for the crops that we wanted, coffee, soil, and other elements. So let's exemplify it, because we wanted a semi-automatic process that demands just little human effort. So what we call about low labor labeling? So we need just few examples that must be labeled by a specialist and images of related images. So, looking at a small part of the GUI image here that we put tiles on it, we asked the specialists to tell us, please give us 3 or 5 examples of coffee, of forest, and from this image we got 5 examples of 3 of forest, 3 of soil, and 2 of corn. And with only 13 examples, that is just 0.3% of the given data, we could label the whole image like this. Well, if we zoom at some interesting parts, we can see that we can well separate the soil, the forest, and the coffee. We can even separate the trees among coffee areas, and also the small forest, which is a big problem for the competitive methods. They cannot do that. When we compare with the maximum likelihood approach, it makes confusion between coffee and forest, like we can see here too. Well, so we asked the specialists to do qualitative analysis, and QMAS was elected as much better approach, mostly regarding coffee. For corn, we have to work a little bit more. Well, so the achieved results so far are regarding the development tools for storage, for retrieval, and analysis of data from climate model executions, from climate measures collected by meteorological station and any kind of sensor, and from satellite imagery. So I am with the database and image processing group. We developed theories to do all of these parts, considering heterogeneous and complex data volumes. We applied exception mining techniques to identify and to adjust deviations in the data generated by the models, and in order to increase the effectiveness of the prediction models. This is still under development. And we extended the state of the art regarding spatial-temporal data mining for agroclimate applications. So the challenges that we had to overcome so far was how to develop computational techniques that support exploring climate data, producing knowledge for decision making in a timely manner. This is quite important for us. and to bridge the gap on the heterogeneity, because we have images from different resolutions, data from different sensors, and so on. And to analyze the data behavior variation over time and identify the temporal patterns when the focus is on monitoring time series. Those are some of the papers that we produced from this project. I put them, so if you want, you can look at them. Those are our partners here. I am from the Mathematics and Computer Science Institute from the University of São Paulo. We have colleagues from CEPAGRE Unicamp, from CPTEC INPE, from Embrapa, from Federal University of São Carlos and Federal University of ABC. This is our website. You will get a lot of information from there. And I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Agma. We have time for a question. Is there a question over there?
Thank you very much for your very nice presentation, very nice tools to identify different plantations and forests. I was just wondering, because NADVI is known to be a not very good measure of the vigor and greenness in forests, and to define forest and savanna. I want to know how this behaves, because I saw that you have only a binary combination, like green or blue and red, right? Mm-hmm. How is it for plantation? Does it work nicely, or the numbers you see really measure the vigor of vegetation on the field? That is the question.
You mean the CUMAS approach when we did the low labor labeling, right?
I think you used NDVI for both, right?
No. For the CUMAS, we employed another feature extraction method, which was based on Gabor filters. So you are correct. We couldn't use just NDVI.
Okay.
It would not provide the correct results.
Okay. So that's why it's better. The CUMAS is better.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any other additional questions? No. Well, thank you, Akma, for your presentation. Thank you very much. And we move to the third and final presentation. So this is going to be presented by Rosane de Freitas. She's from Federal University of Amazonas. And she's going to be presenting on optimization of forest Amazon big data.
Good morning. It's a great pleasure to be here. And the global challenge that I address in my talk is related to the estimating of the carbon stocks of the Amazon rainforest applying two-dimensional high-resolution remote sense and computer science theoretical approach. I'm from the Institute of Computing at Federal University of Amazonas in the north of Brazil. And this work is part of a larger project conducted by Miro Higuch. He's a strong researcher in forest management and forest dynamics that works in the Brazilian National Institute of Amazonian Research. And there is a huge project named Carbon Dynamics of Amazonian Forest that's been undertaken partnership among several institutions and countries, such as the Brazilian National Institute for Space Research, the Japan International Cooperation Agency, the Japanese Scientific and Technology, the University of California, Stanford University, and my university, Federal University of Amazonas, and so on. Among many interesting issues related to forest dynamics, we are interested, as I said, in estimating carbon stocks by means of extrapolation and spatialization based on forest inventory using LIDAR remote sense. That means light detection range technology. And also applying computer science theoretical models and techniques, specifically this following: combinatorial optimization, graph theory, image retrieval, pattern recognition, and machine learning techniques. The motivation can be expressed by this quote given during the intergovernmental panel on climate change, indicating that there is an urgent need to provide additional guidance on the design of forest monitoring systems, including issues such as forest inventory design, stratification, sampling pools, accuracy, uncertainty assessment, and the combination of ground-based inventories with remote sensing and modeling approach. That is exactly what we are performing. But why forests? Why this importance of the forest? And why Amazon rainforest? This is the reason forests sequester and store more carbon than any other terrestrial ecosystem and are an important natural break on climate change. And in this context, the Amazon rainforest is the largest tropical rainforest of the world, with more than 5 million square kilometers. The Amazon rainforest is placed in the north of South America, with the majority of its content within Brazil, with 60% of the total amount, and the other, the remaining, within Peru, Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador, Bolivia, Guyana, Suriname, and French Guiana. So, Amazon rainforest is the largest tropical rainforest of the world, and the most biodiverse tract of tropical rainforest also, with about 400 billion individual trees divided in a number of species. It's not also a very large forest, but also a complex ecosystem. There are a twisted entanglement of tree branches. And so, identify a tree, an individual tree here, it's a hard task. And of course, we want much more than this. About the process of carbon stocks estimation. The carbon pools are in all living and all non-living biomass. And by biomass is calculated based on leaves, twigs, branches, trunk, and roots, and all of parts of a tree. And to get this, we performed the forest inventory in two ways: by ground-based inventory and inventory with remote sensing. And a forest inventory is a systematic collection of data and forest information for analysis with a set of measurements such as the number of species, the diameter at breast high of a tree, the height of a tree, the site quality, the age of a tree, and so on. About the ground-based inventory, is done by forest engineers and technicians that previously established permanent plots. And in this area, in these permanent plots, performed the measurements, the necessary measurements, as I said before. And we want to determine the representative trees, the largest and the tallest trees of this area, of these permanent plots. And of course, applying allometric equations are mathematical models derived of linear and nonlinear regression analysis And these equations are widely used as in a direct means of estimating forest biomass of an area. As you can see here, a better way to estimate the biomass is statistically cut down a number of trees in a permanent plot to better estimate the biomass. And we can see here, this technician is calculating a diameter of this tree. And in this process, the harvest process, we want to realize, to perform a drying process. There is an about 40% of water, and the remaining is the dry mass, the 60%, and 48% of this quantity is carbon. So, in a ground-based inventory, is an easy task to determine the dominant trees, the larger trees, the larger diameter trees. But determine the tallest trees is not an easy task. We need another kind of process, and so we can apply remote sensing in one of the two ways, or in both simultaneously. By satellite remote sensing or aerial remote sensing. In this case, in our work, this is our focus. So we have an aircraft and a device here, the LiDAR device, to perform the scanning of the forest. There is a airborne system comprising a laser scanner device that we put here on the underside of this aircraft, an inertial measurement unit, and a GPS. Another vehicle is a manned aerial vehicle, as you can see here, an octopter. We have two of this model, and also we already performing overflights using aircraft. So the data. The data generated by LiDAR techniques is a cloud of points, georeferenced three-dimensional points, or laser images, as you can see here. And this image, in this image, we can see the canopies of the trees. A preliminary result that we got was an algorithm to determine the average height of a permanent plot of a part of a forest is an initial result, but we have to determine the digital terrain model and the digital surface model. And another preliminary and ongoing results. This research is an initial step in a point of view of computer science. We are applying graph methods for reconstruction of the forest from the cloud of, of points. We are applying also method risk strategies, specifically simulated annealing, for minimize the sample size of the big data, the forest big data, and also to extract features from these points. And an interesting model, we model the cloud of points by graph covering problem to get the dominant and emergent trees. And some interesting results appear. Issues to be addressed involve high cost, of course, the cost of equipment, the fly hours, and so on. There are governmental prohibitions related to aircraft overflights, mainly. Of course, there are technological and scientific challenges. And there are few works with advanced focus in computing science. For us, it's a great thing. This is a multidisciplinary research group. In my university, we have some. João Marcos of the Image Information Retrieval, Eulanda, the Pattern Recognition and Machine Learning, and myself of Combinatorial Optimization and Graph Theory, and some graduate and undergraduate students. And our main research partners, of course, is the leader, Niro Higuchi, of the INPA, and his doctoral student, and Jeffrey Chambers of the University of California at Berkeley. That is my thanks.
Thank you. Thanks. Any questions? There's a question over there.
Yeah, so for the Opticopter approach, is the expense primarily the hardware, or is it the person having to drive it? What because
to driver.
Okay, what I'm wondering is
to programmer the flight of the Octopus.
So it's just carrying out some pre-programmed flight path.
Yes.
Okay, because I'm wondering if there's any if there's any opportunity for like citizen science where you can make these available to people and then have them in the communities, you know, make flights in their own communities to take acquire data, and they feel more invested and they may be able to save you some money in that somehow.
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm. There are many possibilities. This is a very interesting.
Do you have any other questions? Well, I think we're just finishing on time. And please join me to thank the three speakers, and please an applause to all of them. Thank you.